Welcome to Words of Aloha with Pastor Izzy Manzo of Amazing Grace Ministries International. We're headquartered in Kailua Kona on the Big Island of Hawaii. Join us now as we get into God's Word.
Father in heaven, we thank you for this awesome place to gather to worship, Lord, and we just pray that right now we would just turn all of our problems over to you. Help keep distractions away, Lord. Help us put our attention to you. Open up your word to us, Lord, that we can be fed and we can learn about who you are and how much you love us and what you have for us. And Lord, we thank you for the fruit that you have ready for us, that we can just serve you and follow you and trust you. We pray now that you'd use Pastor Izzy to speak to each one of us. Lord, we pray that just as that breeze is blowing in off the ocean to refresh our physical bodies, Lord, that you would send your Holy Spirit to refresh our spiritual bodies. Amen. We ask that now in Jesus' name, and all God's people said,
Amen. Well, good morning, guys. Would you turn your Bibles to Romans chapter 12? We are coming to one of my all-time favorite. Now, my wife says I say this about every passage, but this is really one of my all-time favorite passages of Scripture. And the end of chapter 11, we saw the gifts and the callings of God are without repentance. They're irrevocable, another translation says. In other words, when God gives a gift, he's not an Indian giver. We saw that in context, Paul was saying God gave salvation first to the Jews and then to the Gentiles because the Jews had rejected Christ as the Messiah for the majority. Not all of them did, but I'm talking in generalization. The majority of them rejected Jesus as the Messiah. And so the Lord then gave us the privilege as Gentile believers to have a very special role in their lives. And what was our role to be? What were we supposed to do for the Jews as Gentiles? We were to make them what? Jealous. We were to literally be the ones that stimulated them to want to get back and close to God by simply saying, oh, we're so glad that your God is our God and he let us be close. We feel so close to him. It's because of you guys, you know. They're like, huh? I'm not close to him. Oh, but I feel so, I mean, it's so wonderful, the forgiveness I feel, the grace, the mercy. You know, it's new every morning. Like it says in Lamentation. Jeremiah wrote that. You know, the steadfast love of the Lord never what? Ceases. And his mercies, they never come to an end. Oh, I'm so glad I feel the mercy of God every day. And they look at you like, I don't feel that. I don't feel the, you know, that compassion on my life. I'm struggling. And you're like, well, you know, it's because of you guys I get to be close to you. So I feel so close. And then we're supposed to stir them by way of jealousy, make them jealous. We should be so close to God in our lives that they're saying, I want to be close. You know, you want to really witness to a Jewish believer or a Jewish person who needs to become a believer, then what you need to do is you need to draw close to God in your own personal life. This is not, hey, you guys need to go get close to God. You know those guys, I hate those guys. Do as I say, not as I do. I'm not really wired for those kind of preachers. I like to take them all and put them in a bucket, and I can't say what I would do with them, but it wouldn't be good. I like to get rid of them because that's not really blessing the body of Christ to tell people go do these things and not live it. I try my best to do the other approach, which is what Paul used. He said, guys, if you don't know how to do this, all you have to do is be an imitator of me, as I am an imitator of who? Who is Paul imitating? Christ. He says, you don't know how to. Now, if you want to improve your spiritual walk, say you got a witness to one of your friends, and they go, but I don't know how to do this Jesus thing. All you got to do is get bold and say, that's okay, just copy me. Everything you see me do, you just do, and I'll copy Jesus, because I've been following him a little bit. You can just, you know, I'll be an open book. You just copy me as I copy him, and you'll know what to do. Some of you are looking at me like, forget that. Why? You have something you wouldn't want them to copy? You have just identified all areas of sin in your life. Because you should be able to live your life in such a way that people can see what you do in the light of the Lord and say, oh, that's the right way to live. If we live like that, we're not just talking this talk, we're walking the walk of faith. We're showing by example what to do. And now Paul has been saying, guys, this is what the Lord has done. And today we pick up this very special passage, Romans 12, verse 1, where we read here, it says, therefore I urge you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present yourselves a living and a holy sacrifice acceptable to God, which is your spiritual service of worship. This is the verse I use all the time for the worship team members. I tell them, this is worship 101. You know how people, what do we have to do to be on your worship team? I say, you got to go read Romans 12, 1 and 2. Mandatory. To be on my worship team, you know, this is what we have to do. We have to, as the worship team members, we're supposed to be presenting ourselves to God. Here I am, God. I present my body to you for service. Whatever, living holy, holy means set apart, separated for a consecrated use, whatever God would want to use me for. So here I am, God, use me. I got to share that with, someone was asking how was the cruise that we just went on, and we got a last minute deal. Some people didn't know we were going. We didn't want to tell you because some people won't go to church if they think the pastor is not going to be there. But see, I heard Dave did a great job, so thank you, Dave. Guys, I have to tell you, this is what on the cruise, we got to meet a couple on the cruise, and we were talking to them about our faith, and they were saying, well, we saw some homeless people in Maui, and we were really felt really, you know, heavy in their heart about it, and we were praying for them, and in our morning devotion time, and I said, well, we feed the homeless every week at our service. Oh, that's wonderful. We would want to come to your service. And so we got to know these folks, and we were on the cruise with them. I'm thinking, Lord, you have a great sense of humor. That I go, well, they go, what do you do? You know, I'm a pastor. Oh, well, do you have your sermon ready? When do you preach this? I said, Sunday, when we get back. They said, do you have it written out? I said, I never write. You guys know me. I just memorize the text. If I know the text, I can share from that, and I've had years to study through the word and look up the Greek, the Hebrew, you know, learn this so I can share, like Paul says, what I receive from the Lord, that's what I want to deliver to you. Always stick to, by the way, when you share your faith, don't say what some other guy received from God in some book you read. If it spoke to your heart, like Pastor Chuck taught me, if God used me to speak and it sunk into you, it's not Pastor Chuck said, or it's not Pastor Izzy said, it's the Lord just used those guys. They're just nobodies. But he used them to speak to me. And once he speaks to you, it's yours. So you can share with them, this is what God has given to me. I learned this. You know, God spoke to my heart. And now it's yours. Free game. Just use it all you want. Because when you share with something that God has given to you, that personal part, that's when it's sweet. So they're like, did you write out your sermon? I said, no, but this part really means a lot to me. All we're supposed to do is say, worship 101, here I am, God. I present me to you, a living and holy sacrifice. And you say that's acceptable. The acceptable service of worship is simply just, how many of you wake up in the morning and go, here I am, Lord, use me? Or, you know, it might be some form of that prayer. Good morning, God, what do you have for my day? Give us this day our daily bread. Lead us not into, you know that part, right? Into temptation, deliver me from evil. For thine is the kingdom, thine is the glory, thine is the power. Everything is for the Lord. See, when we pray that prayer, our attention swings off of us to who? To the Lord. So worship 101 is taking our eyes off of us and putting them toward the Lord. You know, saying, Lord, let me put my eyes to you. I present myself alive. I'm just yours. Use me how you want. And God says, that is acceptable worship. That's what he really desired. What happened if we all did that this week? We woke up, good morning, Lord, here we are, use us. Do you think we'd be used? Do you think that we would have divine appointments in our week? I mean, I tell you, our God is so good at setting our calendar if we let him. You know, On the cruise we went on, people have been asking, what happened? How was it? They were so kind to us. I had taught last time we went. When I returned, I said, guys, we need to have an attitude of gratitude. That's what I told my kids on the cruise. Write out the little compliment card. I didn't call them comment cards. I said compliment cards. Kids, write out your favorite person, your favorite waiter, your favorite, you know, person that you know, maybe is the director of the youth program, whatever, and write something nice about them, and we'll put them in the box. Well, that was over 6 months ago. And when we went back, guess what? We walk in, and the waiters and the staff are running up and hugging us. Like, oh, you guys, you're back. The Manzos are here. You'd hear them say, the Manzos are here. And then they run to the next, and the waiters would come running out to greet us. And we were like, who are we? We're not rock stars or anything, you know. We just said something kind. You know what? When you're in the service industry, what do you usually get to hear when you're the waiter? The complaints. The complain. And some people, I don't know how to tell you, so they're not all with aloha spirit. Because they come from some other places, and I don't know what they trained them to do back east, but man, do they complain. There was a few of them. I know the accent because a lot of my family's from, you know, they don't ask for water. They ask for water. And they talk real funny. And what? Dottie. Like Dottie. No, shh. And I see you. She's my sweetheart. So they were a little bit of these complainers on these ships, you know. Well, I shouldn't say a little, a lot. And I wrote after our cruise, I said, you know, I want to bless the top guy who really made our cruise last time beautiful, you know, like did some special things for us. And I said, who do I write to? And you guys remember Holland and Stephanie from church, the black couple that Holland would do the announcements. They've moved to Vegas now, but Holland says, you don't write to the ship. You write to the corporate office. You find out who the boss of that guy is. And you write a letter to him. And he goes, and don't even use email. Use real paper. They don't do that anymore. You know, you really want to make an impression, like mail it there. And I tried, but I didn't get it printed, but I did send an email with pictures, because I'm a picture guy. But pictures from this person was a blessing. You know, we got a picture with them, and this person really went out of their way, and this person. And the last guy is the head of the hotel director, Kai. That man, he should get a little extra star for sainthood, because they'd be complaining to him about, my tour bus was 5 minutes late. I had to stand on the sidewalk. And he's like, oh, we're so sorry. We'll let us make it up to you. Next time we'll make you just have a wonder. And I'm thinking, suck it up. I mean, you're in Hawaii. 5 minutes is like nothing. You look around. Look at the birds. Look at, you know. But they were complaining, hoping to get something. And they're on a cruise where everything is supplied. Why do you need to complain? So I wrote to the corporate office like Holland suggested and said, I just want to write a letter that shares our attitude of gratitude for these people and all that they did. And I didn't know if it would do anything. You ever, you know, sometimes you do this thing and you're like, do they ever get, I was hoping he'd at least somehow get word that he got a good, you know, pat on the back or something. Well, when I wrote him last week and said, we're coming, we got a last minute deal. They give these in-state deals, by the way, for last minute for us Kama'ainas. And so if you're local, you can use them. And we get the deal. And I write him. I said, the poor girl she's in Mesa, Arizona, and she's booking the cruise saying, Pastor, I know you really want to go on the thing. But I said, well, it says right on your website you got a room open. She said, but my thing says there is no rooms open. I said, don't worry. I got total peace. I'll talk to my boss. She didn't get it. I was like, don't worry, my boss works everything out. I said, and I'm going to write to someone. I don't know. 5 minutes, as soon as we hung up, I was like, dear Kai, thank you we're coming back. We're so excited. The poor girl is worried about us getting a room. I'm not worried. You guys make dreams come true. You know what? I got a reply. Glad you're coming back. Tell us when you get here. We'll greet you. It's like, you're going to greet me? Okay. They don't do that, you know, like, but at least not in my world, but they sent someone to greet us, and they said, just wait right here. Someone's going to be here. And they took us into the ship. They go, do you want to get your picture taken and sit with the people at the Lord's? No. Good. Come on. We're going to take you to the steakhouse. and it's all set, and there's a nice buffet. You just wait in there till your room is ready. And guess what? We had a room. All taken care of. Balcony. Yay! We're like, this is the bomb. And because us from Hawaii, we're not used to air conditioning, so we open the thing all night. You know, just leave it open, and we get the nice sea breeze, and it's like we're used to, and your lips don't dry out, and you don't have to do the whole, you know. So I was like, Lord, you're so good. And then they just blessed us over and over. Like, oh, by the way, you can eat here at the nice restaurant. We want to bless you and thank you for. And I thought, does he know that I wrote him a letter? And I saw his reply, and under the bottom it said in little words, see more. See more what? So I clicked it, and the email opened up, folded. There was a letter from the corporate office, and then it said, see more, and I clicked it, and that was my letter to the corporate office. So it did go to him. I mean, he got my letter forwarded back to him from the corporate office with a nice pat on the back from them. And I thought, okay, does it work? Does an attitude of gratitude bless anybody when they're working hard? Yeah. It made his day. And it made our day. So the people who think complaining is a better route, I suggest to you, try this route, what the scripture teaches. Just be grateful. You know, there's so many things we have to be grateful for, but we get so busy. We forget we got a God who cares about us, that loves us, that we can say, here I am, Lord, good morning. Could you just guide my day? And if you pray that, will he guide your day? If you present, here I am, worship 101, pastor said, this is what I got to do. You really want to be a worshiper of God, all you got to do is say, here I am. Present yourself. I can't do this for you. If I could, I'd make you all stand up, present yourself to God. So I grew up in a military family. They do that to you, but not to present you to God. It's like, roll call, stand up, present yourself. Sergeant comes through, inspection. That's a different kind of but you're presenting yourself, right? Attention. And you're standing there waiting, and they're looking you over. But see, as Christians, we're supposed to do this voluntarily. Here I am, Lord. I present myself to you. Use me however you want. Now, there's a second verse that goes with this, verse 2 of Romans, and this is another one that is really a really important thing that we do if we want to be, well, if you want to be on the worship team. This one I think is as important as verse 1. Verse 1, we're going to present ourselves alive, living in holy sacrifice. Verse 2 says, and do not be conformed to this world, but be what? Transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you might prove what the good and acceptable will of God is, that which is perfect. This is where the real rubber meets the road as Christians. Do you want to prove to your friends that there's a God? See, and that he loves them? I say this because it says you get to prove what the good, acceptable will of God. What is God's will? What's God's will for all men? You guys probably know this. Well, Peter wrote this. Remember in Peter, he said, it is the Lord's will that none should what? Perish. He doesn't want a single soul to perish. If some people say, well, God just wants people to go to hell. No, he doesn't. His will is that none would perish. I'll show it to you just in case you're a note taker. 2 Peter, if you're driving, don't stop and write. Just keep listening, and you can listen again on YouTube if you need to. It'll be there. But this is 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. He says, the Lord is not slow about his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you, not willing, not his will, not wishing for anyone to perish, but for all to come to repentance. God wants everybody to come to repentance. Because when we come and say, Lord, I repent of my sin, he says, I forgive that. Just like we took communion this morning. And we said, Lord, forgive us. He goes, done. The slate is wiped clean. You're clean. Those of you that asked the Lord to forgive you this morning, guess what? You're starting your week off clean. Your sins have been washed, removed. And it's such a, I don't know about you, but it's a refreshing way to spiritually kick the week off when we have communion, isn't it? You get that boost of it's just a reminder. We know the Lord forgives us all the time, but sometimes we need, with these gray minds, gray matter, to be reminded of real, true spiritual truths, that to let them sink in. Communion for me does that. It makes it real. Oh yeah, he does forgive. Oh yeah, his body was broken. His blood was shed for me. So I could have forgiveness. And it says we do this to proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Well, back to Romans chapter 12. If you want to prove what God's will is, do you want to prove to your friends that God wants no one to perish? You know, he really wants them to be included. Maybe you have a family member that's a little bit stubborn. Part Italian, maybe. Like our family, Sicilians, they're the worst. But on the stubborn side, I'm saying. Except for the Germans. My wife's German, so she says that they're a little more stubborn. But we'll call it a tie so we don't get into family squabbles. But see, I think probably every culture has the stubborn ones, right? And maybe you have one of those ones, you're trying to be a witness to them, and they're just dragging their heels. And you want them to know that God really wants them to come to salvation. How do you prove that? You know how you prove it? Right here. Do not be conformed to this world. Do not let this world press you into its mold. Do not let this world make you live like the worldly people live. But, you know, the world says, okay, it's Friday night. What do you got to do? We got to go party. I mean, come on. Can't you hear the bar? They're pouring the drinks already. The happy hour started. They got the salty snacks on the bar already. Come, eat them. That's such a setup, don't you think? They put that sweet and salty stuff, and you eat it, and then what happens? Then you got to have a drink, wash it down. And then, you know, it's like, and then as soon as you get that drink partway down, they shove another bowl in front of you. Doesn't matter, popcorn with little peanuts, you know, or sweet, oh, yeah, when they put those little sweet toffee peanuts with the salty popcorn. You know, sweet and savory, salty. It's like the Food Network. They study it. And then they go, here, have a bowl of this free. Complimentary, because we're going to charge you $15 for the drink you're going to drink to wash it down. And by the time that you have a couple of them, you'll loosen up your pocketbook, and we're going to be giving you the worst snacks. It doesn't matter. They're free for us, but we just give them to you because you get thirstier. Right? And they keep doing, and there's this whole, well, my friends are doing it, and everybody wants me to go do it with them, and there's kind of this worldly pressure to conform to this. It's the weekend ritual, don't you know? Well, I want to prove that there's a God that doesn't want anyone to perish. And I prove it by not being conformed to this world. I don't go with that pattern. My mom, by the way, was an alcoholic for many years. She will tell you she still struggles with it. And except for the grace of God, I think there was nothing powerful enough to break that spell in her life except for the Lord Jesus. When he came into her heart, she goes, I am born again. I'm a new person in Christ. And I went, yeah, right, lady. I wasn't a believer yet. She goes, no, really, Jesus is going to change me. He's going to free me. I said, just in case you didn't know, I was a little cynical back then. I'll believe it when I what? When I see it. And because I knew how she used to sneak the alcohol. She had a stash under her bed. And when you're a child of an alcoholic, you know what alcohol smells like on someone's breath. And there's no hiding it. And you know that their behavior changes, and you see it, and you get to see there's happy drunks, there's mad drunks, there's melancholy drunks, there's a whole assortment of them. Whatever personality traits seem to be predominant in those people seem to come popping out when they have a little extra to drink. And I watched those things, and I said, yeah, right, there's a God, sure. And she goes, no, he is going to free me. And you know what? I started noticing her alcohol under her bed was staying at the same level. You know, the bottles weren't going down. And then one day, she came home from church and just said, I don't need these anymore. They shouldn't be under my bed. I need to throw them out. And she went in the kitchen and poured them all down the drain and threw the bottles away. And I was like, Jesus thing seems to work for her. We're going to see if it hangs. You know, like I'm just thinking, it's just a phase. But see, if you're going to prove that there's a living God that wants to change people's lives, he wants them to come to salvation, who do you have to let him change first? Yourself. You cannot let the world press you into its mold and go with it. In fact, you have to be transformed, changed from this worldly way into a newness of life, what we've been studying about, a newness of life in the Spirit. And in this newness of life, my mom started to not go get drunk. And she started coming home from church, and she looked happier when she came home from church than she looked when she came home from the bar. And there was no hangover. And there was no stale breath, you know, the smells. They were gone. And now, I wasn't the easiest nut to crack, so it took a while for God to continue to transform her life in front of me and me watching like a hawk. And by the way, if you don't think that the unbelievers watch us, you're fooling yourself. They don't they know, hey, aren't you a Christian? Are you supposed to live like that? I mean, you said you're a Christian, and you're doing that? And they call us on it right away. You want to prove to them there's a God that loves them and wants their life to be changed, to save them. Let him transform you. Worship 101 isn't just saying, here I am, God. I present myself to you, but I don't want you to change me. I don't want to be transformed. It's, here I am, God, do whatever you got to do with this hunk of clay. Mold me, make me, shape me. Didn't the psalmist say stuff like that? Make me into that vessel that you can use for your consecrated use, whatever you need to use me for. Lord, just, you're the potter and we're the clay. Do your work. And if you do this, it says all you have to do is let yourself be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You know, I had to learn a whole lot of new ways of thinking when I became a Christian. When I gave my life to Christ, I literally needed an overhaul up here. Mental reworking up in the brain department. And by the way, looking back, that was a good thing that I needed. I mean, I didn't really realize how bad it was, but see, God's very patient. And he will work on us little by little. So patient. But I have to let him renew my mind. And some of you, you know the areas where your mind has faltered. Maybe you recognize the pitfalls that your brain defaults to. You struggle with them. You kind of find yourself going back to the same old thinking, you know. Sometimes we struggle with things like unforgiveness or hurt. Someone hurt us, and we can hold on to the hurt and unforgiveness at the same time. For those real jerks that hurt us, you know. Double whammy them. We think we're double whammying them. Who's really getting double whammied when we hang on to hurt and unforgiveness? Who's it really affect? Ourselves. And then we say, why don't you be a Christian like I am? Full of hate and hurt and unforgiveness? They're like, I don't need to join that club. I'm already there. Right? This is what the unbelievers do. See, Romans 12, 1 and 2 can be this whole standalone sermon. That we got to let God transform us by renewing our minds so we can prove to those dear ones that we want to come to salvation that there is a living God. We got to let him start with us. Okay, Lord, here I am. Clean me up. Fix me. Help me let go of that unforgiveness. You know, I remember hearing those sermons about forgiveness. You should forgive. Jesus says, if you don't forgive, what happens with our forgiveness if we don't forgive? Do you remember this in Matthew, the Lord's Prayer? Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. What did you just pray? If that is not a loaded prayer, maybe you haven't thought this one through. You just said, God, forgive me as I forgive those that have sinned against me, right? What if you don't forgive them? That person really hurt me. I'm not forgiving them. I'm never going to forgive them. I'm never going to forget that. Oh, by the way, God, forgive me as I don't forgive them. He goes, okay, you're not forgiven. Do you see that that's loaded? I don't know about you, but That's the only part of the Lord's Prayer in Matthew 6 that the Lord goes on to make commentary about. He doesn't go on to talk about give us this day our daily bread part. We all do that. No explanation necessary. But you know the one part he revisits? He says, for if you do not forgive your men whom you see, then your Father in heaven will not forgive you. The only topic he hits double whammy on is the forgiveness issue. And every time the preacher used to preach about forgiveness, I'd only have one person really pop to my mind that I wasn't forgiving. And God would just work on me. Are you going to be changed? Are you going to let your mind hear what I'm saying to you? Because, you know, sometimes we can block out what God's telling us. You know, we can hear a great sermon about forgiveness, and we know we have unforgiveness, but we ain't letting it go. And so you know what the Lord does? He's so kind. He just waits till the next opportunity. You know, the radio or something. You turn it on, and the preacher on the radio just happens to be talking about unforgiveness. And then you go somewhere else, and you're just sitting in the restaurant, and the people next to you are these two Christians going, you know, God's really been working on me. I've got to forgive these people, and I don't really want to, but I know I shouldn't. You're like, what is it? Everywhere I go, they keep saying unforgiveness, unforgiveness. You've got to forgive. And have any experienced this where God's trying to work on an area in your life, and it seems like it doesn't matter if it's Ross, Safeway, wherever you go, somebody's there. Divine appointments, he's like, we're going to work on this. Well, thank God we have a living God who's patient. And finally, one time after I don't know how many forgiveness sermons, I finally went, I think you really do want to get this out of the way, don't you? He's like, duh, you're a slow learner. Let it go. And I finally did. And you know what? After that, it's kind of fun to hear unforgiveness sermons because I'm like, I let it all go. Doesn't even bug me anymore. Preach away, preacher. See, but if you're holding on to unforgiveness, it can make you a little squirmy. I see some of you. That's the advantage of being up here looking at you. But, you know, you shouldn't squirm. God is trying to transform us. If we, I want to go do Sunday school. Look, they're having more fun. Don't worry, that's good. But you know, it's so cool to have the parents come and say, my kids have made me come back here because their Sunday school was so fun with Aaron and with Luke, and they just had a great time. And I'm like, praise the Lord, that's the kind of Sunday school you want. I mean, it's kind of tough having Sunday school on a beach, don't you think? And I remember when Lorena Hunt was doing the Sunday school one day, we looked over, where's the kids? They were all gone from the thing. And then we see these little heads over there in the cakey pond right there, and they have binoculars in their hands. She had brought binoculars for every kid in the class, and they were learning about God's greatness of creation. And they were standing there like this, looking down, they're ankle deep in water, and they're looking at the fishies, but they got full-size binoculars. And I don't know if you ever tried this. I did it. I went over afterwards because they're having a blast. There was this peppermint candy cane shrimp about this big. Have you seen those ones, the red and white little striped ones? There was two of them under a rock. And if you put your feet there and you just held really still, they'd come forward. And you look at it. They look like, you know, tiny just with a natural eye. But when you look through the binoculars this close, they're like lobsters, you know. And the detail is fantastic. I mean, they are like, there's little hairs on them. I never even knew it until I had this binoculars, you know, just two couple feet away. I'm like, whoa, zoom in, man. Look at that. And the fish, the little fish that's that big, is like this big, you know. Whoa, look at the detail. And she was teaching them, forget coloring a little picture with crayons, you know. We're going to color fishies and octopuses. She's bringing them to the tide pool, showing them the real thing. And saying, God made this and God made that. And the kids were going, can we come back to this church? This is the greatest Sunday school. You know, and I'm thinking, that's a pleasure for a pastor to hear. You know, just warmed it like, wow, for little ones to want to hear the things about the Lord, that they want to come again in here. That's what, to me, that's real success in the ministry. I mean, hopefully that's the same for you guys. You want to come back and hear. What does the word of the Lord speak for me? I need his word to help me make it through the week. This passage here is to help us make it, but to make it with purpose. Sometimes, I'm going to share this with you, sometimes we will not walk rightly if it's just what we think for us. Like, say no one else is around. And we think, well, nobody's watching anyway. I don't really have to be a good example. It's not going to mean anything, right? So we'll fudge a little. Spiritually, that I'm speaking of. Not fudge, like food. Like, on the ship, there was a lot of that. And you know, the thing is that God knows this about how we're wired. Sometimes if we just know that there's somebody watching us, looking up to us, looking for us to just set the right example, sometimes it stimulates, now you might not realize this, it'll stimulate you to do better in your walk. When you do what Paul said, be an imitator of me as I imitate Christ. Go ahead, copy me. When people ask me, what do you do for Sunday school to get involved with Sunday school? I said, are you willing to let the kids imitate you? Everything you do, everything you say, the way you behave, are you willing to be an example, your behavior for their behavior? Because guess what? Do kids copy? Are they mirrors of what they see? I mean, come on, all you parents are going, uh-huh, uh-huh. I mean, they're automatic. You know, when I taught Sunday school, I knew which parents swore. I even knew which swear words. Because when a little kid has swear words coming out of their mouth, you're like, where'd you learn that? Mom and dad say it all the time. Or my dad says that. Or my mom, you know. I like knew which parent said what words. They're not trying to tell on their parents. They're just a mirror. They're copying. But if you have something in your life that you wouldn't want the little one to copy, it's not a good example. You're identifying areas for improvement. You're identifying areas where you need to not let the world conform you into its mold, that you can be transformed and become a light. And you know, some of you would do well to volunteer for Sunday school. It would stimulate your walk. It would make you have to step up a rung. It would make you have to go spiritually, I'm speaking. You'd have to be like, man, I got to put on my best behavior. But see, we can do that for church time. Some of you special saints are so saintly on Sunday, but I see you in town in the week. And it's not the same. But should we be like that? Or should we be able to be the same person we are here that we are out there? See, we really want to live in a way where we live these verses. At least I do. And this is, I've gone long enough this morning with the race and everything late start. I'm going to stop here. Romans 12 is too good for me to just buzz through and, skip over the next part. The next part is really juicy. I mean, spiritually, is that the right word to you? I don't even know if that's the right. Is it a good word? Okay. I'm telling you, guys, the verse 1 and 2 in Greek is one paragraph, okay? Verse 3, starting at verse 3 to verse 9 is the second paragraph of this chapter, okay? Next week, that'll probably be the sermon. Just that paragraph. Trust me, it's juicy. It will feed your, I am telling you, if you have time, read ahead for me. Just read read the whole chapter. I read this chapter out loud to Jan every day on our cruise. I was like, you know what? I could read all over and everything, but I just want to read this chapter over and over out loud. There's so much in it. In fact, I'm going to give you the Izzy challenge for this week. You read Romans 12 every morning or at evening, whatever some of your night owls. I'm not going to press you into morning reading if your brain is still asleep at that time. Don't do it. Whatever your good time is, okay? Some of you in the mornings, some of the evenings. But if you do me a favor, read this chapter. Just like husbands, read it for your wives. Read it to them. You're supposed to be the priest of your house. You read it to your wives. It only takes like, what, a couple minutes to do. It's not a long chapter. But just read it to them. And see if you could start off your week on a good note. Saying, God, I'm presenting my body to you. And then read the next part, what it says to do. And the last part, what it says. And I think you might have a really cool week in your faith. It'll boost your faith. I'm telling you, it was a delight to read this every day to my wife on the cruise. Cruising was cool to me because the food is done. They make the bed for you. They change the towels for you. You get to use a towel, and you can hang it up to reuse, or you can drop it on the floor, and there'll be a new one when you come back. You know, and we wound up getting a Christian gal from the Edna, from the Philippines. We got to visit with her the last day. The poor girl was doing 22 rooms by herself every day. And when we found that out, we were like, you know, because she seemed kind of a little bit strained, you know, like from the previous cruise. But then we found out how many rooms she had to do, and she had no one to work with. I'm like, you're amazing, you know. And she said, well, it's the Lord. I'm a Christian. I go, well, I'm a pastor. Good on, you know. And we got to have just a couple minutes to fellowship at the end of her day. I thought, these people are away from their family for 6 months at a time. And it was so nice just to make a connection. And I gave her a bulletin. I said, oh, we have a YouTube channel if you need some encouragement. Words of Encouragement is on there, you know. And I had just checked it before we left, and we just beat Oprah out this week on YouTube. You know when you type in, like, a search on YouTube, type in words of encouragement, and it's always Joyce Myers, and then, like, Anthony Robbins and Oprah. They're always, they switch places all the time on YouTube. It goes by how many views, recent, all their algorithm. I can't figure it out. But somehow we made it into the top, like, five or six over the last couple weeks. And on the last day before we went on the cruise, I checked, we were above Oprah. We were number three. Just for, I don't know how long it lasts, you know, but for the moment when I did, I was like, yay, we got it. I mean, because every time you go up on the suggested side, the amount of views that we get goes jumping up. And like the one about suicide and loneliness, depression, during Christmas time, those all shot to the top of the list of our words of encouragement. And they kept getting, you know, going to the top. And once they get to the top, the amount of views that you get can go up, you know, 1,000, 2,000 views in one night. Just boom, all of a sudden. And you might not think that people are lonely during the holidays, but there are some hurting people. The suicide one took me away, my breath away. It did the most views during the holiday. I was like, man, it tells me we got some hurting people. They need to know about this God that we serve, that loves us. And if you want them to know, just know this, they're watching you. So let God change you. Live it, and it'll work. That's all I got for you today, so let's close in prayer. Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the sweet truths that you have placed in your scripture for us to be able to visit and revisit, Lord, over and over, that we can be encouraged in our faith. I thank you for the joy and the cheer of the kids over there, having a great time as they end Sunday school today. Just, Lord, fill us all with that cheer. As we go from here, fill us with your joy and your love for this week. I ask it now in Jesus' name. And everyone that agreed with me said? Amen. Amen. Would you guys, let's stand and sing a closing song and send you off in the joy of the Lord.
Mahalo for joining us. If you'd like more information about us, go to our website, AmazingGraceKona.com, and click the link to follow us on Facebook. That's AmazingGraceKona.com. Mahalo, and God bless.